got another old Gibson. This is an L1 from the 1920s. Those who keep tabs will recognize it's very similar to an L3 I worked on last year. Virtually identical in all respects except for some decorative elements. And the stuff I'm going to do to it is also very similar. Needs the same things. The L series of guitars, the L0 and L1, were introduced in 1902, which is coincidentally the same year that Orville and his backers formed the Gibson Mandolin and Guitar Manufacturing Company. Now, Orville Gibson had been producing these distinctive carved top instruments for about a decade at that point. But this is essentially the first commercial archtop guitar design that borrows from the traditions of violin making. Now, Orville's creations were a bit different and even more idiosyncratic than what we see here. One of his major design elements was cutting the outline of the guitar, the sides, basically, from a block of solid material, rather than bending them from thin slats of wood, which is a major departure from, like, plucked instrument tradition. That ended pretty soon after the company got founded. The very early guitars are odd. Odd to look at in that the archings are really kind of bulbous and strange. And frankly, the solid rim idea is just not great on those guitars. Now, rigid sides have come back into vogue in the last 20 years or so, but his was not the way. His partners seem to have quickly realized that Orville was kind of a loose cannon. They passed motions to try and limit his influence, and the wording was like, "Now we're only going to pay him for the actual time he spends working." And they put clauses in his contract to try and keep him under control, because they thought his thinking was rather eccentric. They thought his ideas, his methods became unsound. So he ended up being hospitalized a number of times and died in 1916 of endocarditis, which is a bacterial or fungal inflammation. It's an infection of the heart valves, often contracted by people with really bad gum disease. It's an entry point for the fungus to get into your bloodstream. Anyway, at that point he had essentially been removed from his own company for many years, and in his absence, the design of the mandolins and guitars shifted to be kind of an amalgam of Orville's original ideas and more traditional instrument manufacturing processes. This guitar is from late in the evolution. This is the fully realized form of a round hole arch top. But at the time of its manufacture, Lloyd Lohr's F-hole design for the L5 was taking shape, and that essentially killed these right off. You know, there's some groovy magic that happens with the F-holes and an arch top that combined gives them more volume, makes them more penetrating, which is of course paramount. More volume was needed, as the guitar ended up on the bandstand as a rhythm instrument. Mostly for the benefit of the big band, because even at its loudest, the audience could basically never hear an unamplified archtop guitar played in a dance band setting. And with an oval or round hole, even the band couldn't hear it. So, you know, these were immediately obsolete. So the oval hole got kind of a second-class designation that lasted basically forever. But in many ways, it's not deserved. You know, they sound great by themselves, or in small ensembles, or in front of a mic. It's a different sound from an F-hole guitar, but perfectly usable. I'm not the first person to work on this. There are crack repairs. The binding has been replaced, at least in part. The celluloid on these tends to fall apart and get really brittle. Most of them are missing pick guards and pieces of binding on them. The early ones, up until I think around 1920, had a tailpiece that was a hybrid. It was the standard trapeze shape, but it had a flat block that housed standard bridge pins, which is kind of an odd idea. Those are often missing. The color on this is a little bit weird. I've worked on four of these guitars from the 20s, and this has an odd kind of cherry red component that, I don't know, maybe it was added later? Hard to say. I mean, there's definite finish over top of what seem to be previous stain marks from strums and things. So, I don't know. Maybe it was completely refinished, but if it was, it was a long time ago. You can see how it has sunk into the grain lines here. The neck binding does not have any position dots, which is odd because the originals all did. And we're going to put some on because no one should be that masochistic. This has had a fret job too, I think. Maybe? Oh, it's hard to say, really. Like, seems to be some epoxy fill or something down here in the cowboy cord area. You know, they used very small wire. It's kind of annoying to most people who try to play on it. So refretting is, you know, we're going to put on a bigger wire. And at the same time, we can true up the fingerboard, which is a little bit off. Sometimes these have rather annoying arching on the fingerboard. Like, they're much more radius than you'd expect. Like, it's not a 12-inch radius you find on most Gibsons. Sometimes it'll be like 9 or 7 even. And of course, these have some of the biggest necks you're ever going to come across. I mean, they're genuinely huge. So sanding the radius down and, you know, taking off a millimeter can only help there. So we'll make up a pick guard, and we're going to put on an old DeArmond pickup in this as well. I'm going to take off this flamboyant gold tailpiece. We're going to go back to something a little more austere. After taking the string tension off, I noticed that the center seam is open for a good portion of its length and not level. So that's a priority. There's no bracing in this guitar that crosses the soundboard, except for one tiny little brace right here in between the two tone bars, which run parallel to the strings. So there's a big open expansive top in here. Gonna have to get some glue in and some cleats and make sure this is level. For those who like to build clamping calls quick and use contact cement to hold on the cork, it's a good idea to add some packing tape as a barrier if you'll put them into use the same day. Otherwise, the solvent in the cement could damage the finish. I'm using fish glue in this case, a generous quantity, which I'll paint on and into the crack. And then I'll pump that through with my little suction cup and clean off the excess with damp paper towel. I've got clamps to keep the soundboard in alignment and others to pull it together. I'm going to pull these frets, but let's just measure them for posterity. They are just over 50 thousandths wide by somewhere around 35 thousandths tall. So decent height, very narrow, kind of uneven. And the more I look at them, the more I'm convinced these are actually the original frets. Interesting. I think there's been some super glue used to hold some frets in place here. I'm just scoring along each side to, well, kind of break into that glue, but also just create a slight score line in the ebony along each side of the fret so that when I pull them up, if there's any chipping, which there is often likely to be in an old dried out board like this, the chips tend to stop along the score line rather than continuing out into the board itself or the visible part of the board. Hopefully this will be covered by the new frets. Looking at the fretboard, there are areas where fret sprout has cracked the binding away on the ends of the frets, so we'll have to mix up some goo for that. With practice, you can start to identify the type of glue that was used in holding down the frets by the smell it makes when you're heating it up. In this case, I'm getting a whiff of stake, which is the hide glue, and there's also a complex kind of sweet smell that I associate with CA glue. So these have been well and truly glued. Nice thing about these vintage frets is they have very narrow and shallow tangs on them. So they come away pretty cleanly. This is all glue that was stuffed under the crown of the fret. Sometimes it's nice to have a visual aid. You can see just how ridiculously thin this wire is compared to a standard Martin wire. Okay, the goop is now good and goopy. So we'll build up a coat here on those areas of missing binding. This stuff is effectively a very disturbing color of nail polish.
It's old shavings of binding that have been dissolved in acetone. I made up some spruce cleats, which will be glued in with some magnets. Using a gauge, we can see that this board's radius is somewhere around 8 inches, which is pretty tight for this style of guitar. I've pre-radiused and degreased the fret wire, and then I'll cut each piece to length. After that, I'll nip the ends to overlap the binding and file off any last little bit. I'll remove the nut, and we'll also check out the truss rod. This is one of Gibson's earliest rods, and it's working fine, which is a good thing. Using the 12-inch radius sanding block, I'll start to correct the radius. This will get rid of most of the grunge and get things back in order. Then I'll use a flat sanding beam as well, and then work my way up in the grits to about 1800. Give me a good true board. As luck would have it, I saved the template from the last L series guitar I modified, which is nice, so I didn't have to design another one.
Took this to the bandsaw, then the spindle sander. Got the shape the way I want it. I have to laminate on a second piece to, number one, stiffen this, because this is about 2 millimeters thick. I need some, a little bit extra. And also to accept some pins that will be used to hold the guard in place that go into the side of the neck.
As it turns out, I decided to go with another, slightly less finicky mounting method. To bond these pieces, I need to use a generous splash of acetone and some quick hands. I roughen the parts before I put the acetone on there, and the surfaces to be bonded have to be clean, obviously, and then I use a lot of clamps. I'll do what I can to clean out the dust and some of the gunk in the bottom of the fret slots using a little hooked tool here. This operation is more difficult because of the binding. I couldn't get anywhere near the depth I needed, so I had to pull out the Dremel tool with a tiny 0.6 millimeter bit. You have to be careful with this, and I have to stop frequently to clean off the glue that gets lifted out of the slot because it builds up and it can heat up and burn out the cutter or cause scorch marks on the top of a rosewood board. And this is some very old, very dry ebony, so I have the bottle of super glue close to hand to take care of anything that happens along the way. Fretting proceeds in the usual fashion. I put a little bit of fish glue into the slot using a syringe and position the fret. Place a pounding block underneath it, tap in the ends, and then give it an experimental tap down the center to make sure it's going to seat the way I want it to. Clean off any of the excess glue, mostly for the jaws of my fret press here so it doesn't build up on those. Give it a bit of a squeeze and lock it down tight. Over the body is a bit delicate because there are no braces under there, remember? I need to hold a block to absorb some of the force, and I slightly file the fret barbs so that they go in a little bit easier in this area.
I'm going to change out these anachronistic gold tuners. Looking here, I can see a line that runs across the face of the headstock, which suggests that this was either broken or cut, or this is an inlay piece. And I don't see anything on the sides, but there are definite wings, which, who knows? Who knows what happened in there? There is a little bit of a crack in the finish as well. So, and the surface of the back of the headstock definitely looks refinished. So, I'm beginning to suspect this entire guitar was oversprayed.
I'll measure and mark a point for the side dot markers. The glue has had sufficient time to dry, so I can come back and file off the protruding fret ends. Here I'm scraping a little bevel onto the edge of the pick guard using a razor blade. I found a location I think is appropriate, so I'm working out where the hardware needs to go. have to drill a hole for the bracket, and another beside the fingerboard. I'm going to go straight down into the top. I need to establish a center line for the neck, as this often wanders as different tail pieces are installed over the years. So I use a straight edge on either side of the neck, and that'll give me a place to figure out where to put the new tail piece. There's some holes to plug, and I need a hole for the new barrel jack slash strap button. The owner has brought me this mid-60s DeArmond Hershey bar style pickup, which will try to find a way to attach to the pick guard and have it float. So I'll mark out the position. I'll also figure out how high the pick guard should be. I have to make up a little riser. So I'll scratch up the surface and epoxy that in place. Back to the pickup cutout. I'll drill some holes for clearance and the radius on the edge. Get in there with a saw. And use a jeweler's saw to cut out the shape, after which I'll employ some files and sandpaper.
I'm running into a bit of a situation here in that the support piece I made is contacting the top and holding the pick guard away from where I want it to be, and also making the pickup too high, and the strings would be bumping into it. So I've got to come up with a different attachment method. Now, it's funny how this worked the last time. They're all different. The geometry does not match in every guitar. So
that may have been slightly confusing. I lost the footage of making the pickup support arm out of wood that screws to the pick guard. The previous iteration, it just wasn't working. It was too thick. So I decided some brass plate would be a good alternative, and that I could make threaded holes in it and thus use shorter screws. Here I'm using a tap, which is the device that makes the internal threads. Here I'm cutting the screws to length using some washers as a standoff, because I want to leave extra room in case I need to add a spacer to adjust the pickup height. Boy, that was a surprise. No harm done. Now I can take this apart and bend that piece of brass to the angle I need, so that the pickup's going to end up sitting roughly parallel with the strings. Here I'm leveling the tops of the frets using a sanding beam. Big heavy neck, very stiff, and with a moderate action, I don't have to put this in the neck jig, I can just do it by hand. I'll recrown the tops of the frets that have been flattened slightly by the sanding using a three-corner file. Polishing, polishing, polishing. I'll knock off the corners of the fret ends and shape them so that they're nice and round. I decided some heavy double stick tape was the way to go to hold the DeArmond on, at least for now. The rivet holes in the cover plate on these, I think it's probably off a Stratotone. They're so incredibly small that my thinnest screws wouldn't fit, and drilling them out is kind of fraught with danger. So this is some strong tape, I don't think it's going to move. Fancy strings this time. These are Tomastic Infeld from Austria. They make premium quality violin family strings. Pricey stuff. Reshaping the fingerboard radius means the nut slots for the inner strings are now much too high. These are much nicer to play on. Have I mentioned this thing has a short scale? It's only 24 inches.
All right, that was a bunch of work. I know I say it a lot. But sometimes I'm not sure if the never-ending nature of some of these projects comes through. I really, really like these guitars. I saw a little lecture given by Ken Parker once where he was describing his impressions of the changes that Gibson made between the 1920s and the 1930s archtops, and how they differed, how they went from a kind of eggshell responsiveness to a much heavier volume at all costs kind of philosophy with thicker tops and efficiency measures like cross-cutting kerfs into the braces so that they wouldn't have to individually fit them so carefully. So there's a real difference in their construction. These ones, to my mind, sing in a different way. Thanks for your patience this week. I mentioned in a post that my decade and then some old computer was failing, and I had to get a new one. And of course, the video editing software I've been using forever is no longer available, no longer supported. can't even find a pirated version. So I had to go and get a fancy new one that has a million pull-down menus with stuff I'm never going to use. But, you know, in some ways it's very much less intuitive than my old program. So I'm sure I'll get used to it. Just going to take a bit of a learning curve. Anyway, let's get this, we'll play it unamplified first and then plug it in, see what it sounds like.